So in this lecture, I'll be discussing about how to train an artificial neural network. So today in the first two lectures, we have discussed about what is meant by artificial neuron, how it has its resemblance with a biological neuron, and how to construct an artificial neural network from a single neuron, and what is the need of having different types of structure, architecture. So we have talked about the single layered feed-forward architecture, we have talked about the multi-layered feed-forward architecture and the recurrent type of architecture. Now, after constructing the neural network by means of different neurons, then the most obvious reason for this type of construction is to ensure that the overall ANN system is capable of learning. So in this particular lecture, I'll be talking about the concept of learning, what is meant by learning, and how can we ensure the learning in a single-layer feed-forward neural network, multi-layer feed-forward neural network, and recurrent types of neural network. So as we know, the learning is an important feature of human computational ability. So because of learning, we can perform better in known situation and comparatively good in unknown situation. So this learning can be viewed as the change in behavior. And that happens due to continuous practice and gathering all the knowledge from the experience. So given a set of experience or set of situation action pair to a system, and by virtue of continuous practice and those experience, the learning output will change accordingly. So we know that for a particular situation, if these are the set of inputs, an intelligent system can correspondingly produce some output. On the other hand, based upon the learning, on the other hand, if the set of experience, I mean the set of data which have been provided to the system has been changed and has been modified, and the system gathers experience from the knowledge base, then ultimately, for the same set of input, the output will also vary. And there is a high chance that output or outcome of that particular system tends to approximate something which is much more rational. And that is the idea of learning. If we can train the system properly, then even in some unknown situation, the system will be able to perform in a better way. And here goes the notion of training and testing data. Training data means a set of all those information which are presented during the phase of training the system. And after the training is over, now there is a high chance the set of data with which the performance of the system is evaluated may be a new one. And that set of data is known as a testing data. So during our discussion in classification, we have illustrated this issue in terms of bias variance trade-off. For a quick recapitulation, we can say that for any set of unknown data, if I consider a linear kind of model, linear regression, then it can provide a relatively high bias. On the other hand, the squiggly line will be providing very good performance as far as the training data is concerned. So this squiggly line wins over the straight line approximation over the training data. However, when the new set of data is there for the testing purpose, the performance of the squiggly line can be terribly bad. So the performance is evaluated for any machine learning system not only on the basis of the training data, but also on the basis of the testing data. And so that database or knowledge base of the machine learning system is continuously updated by means of the data presented from experience and the known situation action pair, which is already embedded into the memory of the system. And it is expected that the learning process will last for a relatively long time. And for a system to be an efficient learner, in general, it is expected that the learning mechanism or learning algorithm should also update itself after certain intervals of time. So as far as the architecture of neuron is concerned, or as far as the attribute of neuron is concerned in terms of the learning, we can say that it is nothing but the effective coupling between the neuron. And that makes the learning possible. The way neurons share the information with one another in any particular network, it is having a serious implication on the learning performance. So for an artificial neural network, the concept of biological nervous system has been incorporated with some corresponding analogous electrical equivalent. So in case of ANN, the learning can be regarded as a process of modifying the neural network. So how can we modify the neural network? Okay, we can change the architecture, but for the time being, if I do not want to change the architecture, so even for a single neuron, we can change the corresponding bias, the threshold value, and the weight connection. And in most of the learning algorithms, researchers have put significant stress on updating the weights. So as you understand, there are different weights between the neurons in the architecture. From the input data set, we have a set of weights which connect the input to the first neuron, or first layer of neuron. Then between each layers of neuron, there are several weights, interconnected weights. And depending upon the values of the weight, the output of the ANN system gets modified. So during the phase of learning, the parameters of the network are optimized. And we can say that it's a result of good card fitting. So if I take a look at the learning taxonomy, so it can broadly be classified into three different segments. One is known as the supervised learning, second one is known as the unsupervised learning, and the third one is known as the reinforcement type of learning. Now, what is meant by a supervised learning? We have used this term many a times in this course. Supervised learning means during the phase of learning, during the process of learning, a supervisor must be there to guide you in a proper direction. That means, as far as the input-output combination is concerned, when you go for supervised learning for any system, then for the training pattern, the input and output is presented simultaneously. So the system must know that for this type of input, this will be my desired output. For this input, this will be my desired output, and so on. That can be implemented either by gradient descent means or by stochastic means. So in case of gradient descent means, error correction is done by finding out the gradient, where the objective is to minimize the error component, and which is a deterministic one. And that can be implemented either by least mean square method or by backpropagation technique. On the other hand, sometimes weights are adjusted on the basis of probability value. And then this type of supervised learning is known as a stochastic kind of learning. So in one word, we can say that In case of supervised learning, there is a teacher, there is a supervisor who always provides a system with the set of input and set of output. That means situation action pair is to be known, is to be presented to the system itself. On the other hand, for unsupervised learning, there is no explicit teacher, there is no explicit supervisor. Only the set of input data points is being presented to the system, and the system by its own adapts the parameters, and accordingly it forms different clusters, and on the basis of those clusters it can classify them into different classes. So that could have been implemented either through Hebbian learning or through comparative learning. So Hebbian learning is performed through correlative weight adjustment method, and the comparative learning is represented as a kind of learning where the set of neurons are there and the input signal is being fed to each of the neurons. And on the excitation of the input stimulus, the weights of those neurons will be modified, will be updated. Which neurons answer quickly, respond quickly? So in other words, we can say that this comparative type of learning can be regarded as a type of learning where winner takes it all strategy is implemented. That means if out of 10 neurons, if 5 neurons can properly respond to the system, then the corresponding weights of those 5 neurons will be updated. So under this condition, we can say that 50% of the total neurons have performed well in the competition, and their weights will be adjusted so that a better output can be developed. And the third one is that third type of learning is known as the reinforcement kind of learning. Here also the explicit teacher is absent, that means there is no supervisor, but the system, whenever the system takes some action, then a reward or penalty policy is given. That means based upon the action taken by the system, either a reward is being given to the system so that the system can identify that, okay, it is in the proper direction, it is along the direction of the goal, so that the reward has been provided to it. And on the other hand, if the action is taken against the direction of the goal, then a penalty is being provided to the system. So by the adjustment of this reward and penalty, the system can learn itself. But however, for both unsupervised and reinforcement kind of learning, there is no explicit teacher or supervisor present. So let's start with the supervised learning. So in case of supervised learning, every input pattern is associated with a corresponding output pattern. To train the network, the input pattern and output pattern, they are presented simultaneously to the system. And this phase is called the training set of data, as I've already mentioned. So this input of relationship of the training scenarios are available. So what is the operation being done over here? The system knows what is the ultimate output, what is the desired output that it requires to be produced. However, because of the initial setting of those threshold value and those weight collection, an intermediate output is developed. And this output is compared with the corresponding target value or desired output value. And automatically that error will be calculated. Now, based upon the error, this error signal is used to adjust the weight of the neural network. And as a matter of fact, after a fixed number of epochs, it is expected that the system results in an improvement. That means the error value reduces after certain number of iteration. And this type of learning, as I already mentioned, is called the learning with the help of a teacher. So this weight adjustment is an important attribute of supervised learning. The way the weight is adjusted, we can have two different types of learning, as we've already mentioned under supervised learning. One was the learning through this gradient descent method, which is deterministic in nature. So given the error value, one can easily find out the derivative of the error with respect to the different variables. Suppose the error signal is a function of, say, n variables, say v1, v2, v3, up to vn. So we can draw the error surface in an n-dimensional space. It is very difficult to visualize. It is very difficult. It is impossible to write down or draw the corresponding error surface, which is n-dimensional. But we can conceptually think of that. We have n dimension, and the error signal or error function depends upon those n variables. Now, if it is possible to find out the derivative of the error with respect to those variables, then our objective of the system designer will be to find out the optimum selection of v1, v2, vn, which provides the minimum error value. So that can be done by finding out the gradient function, and that could be implemented either through least mean square kind of error or through backpropagation. So we'll be discussing each of these. And on the other hand, for stochastic kind of learning, the weight adjustment is carried out on the basis of the probability. However, for unsupervised learning, as I've already mentioned, it's a learning without a teacher. System learns of its own by adapting the structural features. So there are certain parameters associated with it. And the machine tries to identify those parameters, tries to extract those parameters, and accordingly, it classifies them into different classes. And the method which we popularly employ for this is known as a clustering method. Hopefully, tomorrow I can have a small session on clustering. So I have already mentioned about this reinforcement learning. Although the teacher is available, but it does not tell the expected answer. Only the computer output is correct or incorrect. That information is given to the system. So the exact output is not being provided. And this information helps the network in its learning process. So let's start with the first type of learning technique, that is the gradient descent learning technique. So what is the purpose here? The purpose here is to adapt the weight. So initially, I'm assuming that except all the parameters, we are considering only the adjustment of W. That means the weight value. However, there are other parameters associated with any learning mechanism. For example, we have the architecture. We can also change the architecture so as to have better learning. a better system. We can also have the other parameters in the form of threshold, in the form of the nonlinear function. But these parameters are not taken into consideration during the phase of gradient descent learning. So let us consider that Wij is nothing but the weight connection between the ith and the jth neuron. And obviously, these two neurons are there in two neighboring layers. That means if one neuron is at layer number L, then the second neuron must be at layer number L plus 1. Because from our discussion on ANN architecture, we have seen that only the neurons residing in two adjacent layers or two neighboring layers, they are connected by means of some weights. So if a neuron is there at layer number 5, that is not directly connected to another neuron lying on layer number 8. So obviously, the link is there between the ith and jth neuron, and these two neurons must be at two neighboring layers. Now, if I consider that E is the error function, and if this value of E is differentiable, then we can easily find out this daily del Wij function. This will give us the gradient, assuming that the error value E is dependent on Wij. And the process has to be calculated, has to be carried out for each such Wij. Because there are a number of neurons, and accordingly, there are a number of such weight connection. So this has to be carried out for all such Wij. And our objective is to find out a situation for which the error becomes the minimum. That means when error is minimum, the daily del Wij will be zero for all Wij. If not, then this particular value, daily del Wij, is used to adapt the weight of the ANN model. And accordingly, we do have one learning rate eta multiplied with this daily del Wij, and sometimes this eta is having some serious say on selecting the value of delta Wij, and sometimes the performance of the overall performance of the machine learning system depends upon the selection of the value of eta. And daily del Wij, as I've already mentioned, is the error gradient with reference to the weight Wij. So this is the fundamental idea behind the gradient descent learning mechanism. And based on this idea, the least mean square and the back propagation models are proposed, and these are considered to be the two variations of this particular learning technique. So now let us start with training the single layer feed forward neural networks. In fact, you will gradually see that whenever we consider the single layer feed forward neural network or we consider multi-layered feed forward neural network, although the basic concept is the same, abstraction is the same, but as far as the calculation is concerned, as far as the execution is concerned, you will see that there is a difference in calculation. So that's why let us start with the first type of architecture, that is the single layered feed forward neural network architecture, and how we can implement the notion of training in those neural networks. So let's try to identify what is the property of this single layered feed forward neural network architecture. Already we have discussed this one in the second lecture, today's second lecture, that there are several neurons arranged in one layer. Because it's a single layer, so all the neurons are there in one layer with inputs and weights connect to every neuron. That is fine. So in this particular case, the weight value can be regarded as a single matrix. And the size of the matrix is nothing but that of the size of the neuron, I mean the number of neurons and the number of input data points. So if I consider that there are say n plus one number of inputs like x0, x1 up to xn, and suppose f is nothing but the transfer function of the neuron, and x bar and y bar is nothing but input and output vectors of this training data set, and w bar is nothing but the weight matrix, then considering all these variables, these are the steps for training the single layer FFNN, SLFFNN. In short, I'm saying single layer feed forward neural network like SLFFNN. So first of all, W1 is nothing but the weight matrix. So first of all, let's start with the initialization process. So here our objective is to find out the optimum value of W bar so that the entire system, entire neural network system, is trained for a set of, for a given set of input output patterns. So to start with, let us assume some random weight value like W0 to Wn. We can assume some random weight value for each of these W. Then in the second step, for each input pattern X that belongs to X bar, so here we are considering that X bar is nothing but the input vector. So if I have P number of input, so then X bar can be written like x1, x2, so it's a column vector, row vector, depending upon your formulation. So X bar is the vector, and you can write it like x1, x2, x3, x4, up to xn. So here it has been mentioned that there are n plus 1 number of inputs. So that's why this X bar is nothing but this one, x0, x1, x2, up to xn. So for each of these, we need to find out the corresponding weighted average, that is WIXI. And this computation is being performed inside the cell body or soma of the artificial neuron. So this is a simple weighted average of the inputs. The weights are W0 to Wn, which we want to optimize. So I is generated from this particular equation, from the summer block. And accordingly, the output is computed. As we have discussed already, y is equal to f of I. And if I consider that the threshold is 0, so if this I is greater than 0, then the output will be 1. And if it is less than or equal to 0, then the output will be 0. So then you'll find some y value. And depending upon the number of neurons in that particular layer, because we are considering single layer feed forward network, so there could have been say p number of such neurons in this particular layer. So accordingly, you could have a series of ones and zeros, like 1100010, like this. So this computation is for a single neuron, and the same thing is repeated for a number of neurons in the single layer. And this bit pattern, like 1001, this bit pattern is nothing but Z output vector, that is Y bar. Now, if this value of Y bar, if it matches exactly with the desired output, then we are happy. So then we can understand that the W bar with which we have done this calculation is perfectly okay, and there is no need to adjust the weight. So this is a step of the algorithm, but as you understand, this weight adaptation process has to be carried out many a times, iteration after iteration, so that an acceptable performance is achieved. So now let's take a look at the step number 4, where we need to update the weight matrix. So under step number 4, three sub operations are being performed. Now for each output Y that belonging to this Y bar, Y dash bar, we have to check whether the observed output is matching with the desired output or not. If the observed output Y is 1 instead of 0, that means the observed output has been more. Ideally, it should be 0. But here, after the computation, we find that the observed output is 1. So under this case, we need to reduce the value of the weights. So then the corresponding equation for weight adaptation is nothing but Wi, or rather I can write like Wi star, that means the new value Wi star is equal to Wi minus alpha xi. On the other hand, if the object value is less, suppose ideal value is 1 or desired value is 1, and what we have 0 at our hand, so then we have to increase the weight value. So Wi star will be called Wi plus alpha xi, and it has to be carried out for all n. You have to check. Now for any particular n, I mean particular I, if the value is same, then we should not do anything. We can leave that operation because the desired output and the actual output matches with each other. So in that case, we don't require to do anything. Otherwise, we have to do this weighted adjustment. And that process has to be repeated many a times. After this step number 4, the next step is go to step number 2. So once again, you have to do the same thing. So at the end of step number 4, the weights are adjusted. Wi star is equal to Wi minus alpha xi, or Wi star is equal to Wi plus alpha xi. So weights are adjusted. So with the new set of weights, once again, we need to compute the I value, which is the output of the cell body, the output of the summer, for new set of input, new set of W, because W has been modified in step number 4. And once again, you have to compute what is the value of Y, and then you need to check whether this Y matches with the observed output or not. I mean, this desired output and observed output, whether they're same or not. And if not, if yes, then you can exit. If not, then once again, you have to enter into the step number 4 and do this. So this has to be done many a times, until and unless this desired output Y bar matches with the observed output Y bar dashed. So if there are n number of neurons there, so you have to do it, you have to check it for all those n neurons. You can only exit from this particular step if and only if the desired output is equal to the observed output for all the neurons. So this is for the single layer feed forward neural net NN training. Next comes the training of multiple layer feed forward neural network architecture. So just like the single layer feed forward neural network also, we can use the supervisory training methodology to train the multi-layer feed-forward neural network. Now let us try to understand, in fact, that architecture has already been discussed in the last lecture, that we typically refer this type of network where we have more than one layer by this LMN kind of thing. When L signifies the number of neurons in the first layer, M signifies the number of neurons in the second layer, and N signifies the number of neurons in the third layer, if it is a case of three-layer neural network. For example, let us consider a situation like this. So we have the first layer like this, three neurons. Second layer, no, it's not three. Actually, they have considered L such neurons in this layer. So 1, 1, 1, 2, 1i arbitrary input, and then 1l. Then 2r, 2, 2, 2j, and up to 2m, and 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 3, 3k, and then 3n. So we have l number of neurons in this layer, first layer, m number of neurons in the second layer, and n number of neurons in the third layer. So this is the first layer or input layer, n1. This is the second layer or the hidden layer, n2. And this is the third layer or output layer, that is n3. And it is assumed that each of the layers are having their own transfer function. That means if I consider the neurons within that particular layer, so each of the neurons in this layer, they follow a particular transfer function. And here they have considered it like to be a linear transfer function. And for the second layer, that is the hidden layer, it's a log sigma transfer function. We have discussed this log sigmoid function that ranges between 0 to 1. So linear transfer function stands for hard limiting function. And these two, log sigmoid and tan sigmoid, stands for soft limiting function. So log sigmoid transfer function ranges between 0 and plus 1. And tan sigmoid transfer function ranges between minus 2 plus 1. So this is a kind of model, but there is no hard and fast rule that you have to follow this particular transfer function. You can select any of the transfer functions depending upon the requirement of the problem. For the illustration purpose, they have used linear transfer function in the first layer, log sigmoid in the second layer, and tan sigmoid in the third layer. It is also possible to mix and match. All the neurons in this particular layer may not be having a same transfer function. Here, for the purpose of illustration, they have considered that all the neurons in this particular layer, they are having linear transfer function, all the neurons in this layer, log sigmoid, and all the neurons in this layer, tan sigmoid. But the situation can be anything. So the inputs are being presented like I1, I2, I3, up to IL, and the corresponding outputs are developed. So this output from this first neuron is represented by this red color. And from the ith neuron in the first layer is represented by this green color. And from the last neuron, the lth neuron is represented by this blue color. And each of the output is being fed to each of the neurons in the next layer. So this is the first layer. So all these outputs, that means this first output, second output, and third output, all of them are being presented to each of the neurons, to the input of each of the neurons. And the corresponding dendrites will collect those inputs from the neurons in the previous layer, in the last layer. And obviously, the weight functions are also associated, W11, W12. In fact, they have mentioned like V here to make sense that V stands for the weight function between the first layer and second layer, and they have used W here. So categorically, they have used two different weight function, V for the weight which is there between the neurons in the first layer and second layer, and W stands for the weight which acts between the neurons in the second layer and third layer. And corresponding input to the second layer is equal to IH. They are mentioning like IH. Output is OH. And then the corresponding, depending upon the corresponding transfer function, this OH and this IO, they are different. So the relation between the output of this neuron and the input of, the output of the summer block and the output of the neuron, this will depend upon the corresponding transfer function. So transfer function will take this I and theta as the two essential input for the linear transfer function, where I is the output of the summer block and theta is the corresponding threshold. For linear transfer function and for nonlinear transfer function, like log sigmoid or tan sigmoid, these two inputs are, one input is obviously I, and the second input is obviously the alpha, because alpha is the role of factor here for the log sigmoid and tan sigmoid transfer function. Then accordingly, the output will be developed over here. So this is all about the specification of this multi-layer feed-forward neural network. So what I have already mentioned, that for simplicity, they have assumed that all the neurons in a particular layer follow the same transfer function, and different layers follow their respective transfer functions as shown in the configuration. And they have considered a specific neuron in each layer, like ith layer, jth layer, and ith neuron, jth neuron, kth neuron, for the input, hidden, and output layer respectively. And to make sense, they have considered two different set of weight matrix. One weight matrix between the input and the hidden layer, which they have identified like V. So V looks something like that: V11, V12, V1j up to V1m, V21, V22, V2m, VJ1, J2, JM, and ultimately VL1, L2 up to LM. So now you can understand what is the importance of matrix in connection to this neural network architecture. So you should have a very clear understanding of matrix while dealing with any neural network system. So we have L row and M column of this particular matrix. So this is the weight matrix identified by V. Similarly, the weight matrix for the second stage, that means the weight connection which join the output of the second layer to the input of the first layer, input of the third layer, is represented by W. So W can be regarded as another weight matrix represented by W11, W12, W1n, up to the last row is WM1, WM2, up to WMN. So as can be identified from this, so we have M neurons in the second layer and N neurons in the third layer. So if I consider exhaustive kind of connection, that means all the outputs of this neuron is connected to all the inputs of the next layer neurons, then we should have M into N number of weights. Similarly here, we should have L into M number of weights. So this is represented by this V of dimension L cross M, and this is represented by W of dimension M cross M. Now, whenever we talk about the learning of this multi-layer feed-forward neural network, so in this particular case, we have to consider three different computations. In fact, the input layer computation, hidden layer computation, output layer computation are not the same. Now let us take a look what happens for input layer computation first. So let us consider that the input training data at any instant B represented by this IL. So this is the vector IL. So this can be represented as like I11, I21, II1, IL1. And if it is considered that outputs of the neurons lying on the input layer are the same with the corresponding inputs to neurons in the hidden layer, then you can consider that this O, that means output of the input layer, is being the same as the input training data. What we mean to say is that, so here within the bracket, they are representing the corresponding dimension of these matrices. And if I find that each of them are having a dimension of L cross 1, now if I consider the input of the jth neuron in the hidden layer, how can this be represented? Let us go back to this structure. So suppose let me consider any jth neuron in the hidden layer. So the jth neuron in the hidden layer, it receives the input from each of the neurons in the previous layer. So, and the corresponding weights value are nothing but V. So the weight values are V. So the input to this jth neuron presented here is given by this particular equation, where V1j, V2j, Vij, and Vlj are nothing but the corresponding weight value. And this O1 dash, O2 dash, OJ dash, these are nothing but the corresponding output resulting from the neurons in the first layer. So this completes the calculation of the input of each node in the hidden layer. So here we have found out the output of the input layer. And here, the input of each node in the hidden layer is calculated. So in the matrix form, this equation can be represented by I is equal to V transpose into O. This is a simple matrix multiplication. So the input of the jth neuron in the hidden layer can be represented by this weighted sum. So V is the weight and O is the output. So accordingly, V transpose into O. Now for any jth neuron in the hidden layer, already you have got what is the input. This input is represented by this ijh. This is the input of the jth neuron in the hidden layer. Then how to find out the output? So as you understand here, the input and output for the jth neuron, for any neuron in this particular layer, hidden layer, is given by the log sigmoid transfer function, where the function is given by 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus alpha I. So the output can be represented by this particular function. So to compute the output, this OJH, we can write like this, 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus alpha into I. And these are the constants. These alphas are the constant. And it is assumed that within a single layer, the alpha value is fixed. That means all the neurons in this particular layer, they may be having different alpha, like alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and so on. Or if I consider to have a single alpha, then it can be represented by single alpha h like this. So here they have considered alpha is to be the constant coefficient of the transfer function. Although in the diagram, they have considered, in this particular equation, they have considered different alpha. So they have written like 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus alpha alpha j I j h. So that depends. Either you can select a fixed alpha throughout, or you can also consider defined alpha corresponding to different neurons. So having considered this one, then ultimately, so this computation is done for a single neuron in the hidden layer, that is OJH. So H stands for the hidden layer, J stands for the jth neuron, and O stands for the output. So OJH is nothing but the output of the jth layer of the jth neuron of the hidden layer. So similarly, in the hidden layer, we have the m number of such neurons. So all the outputs can be represented by means of one dimensional column matrix of size m cross 1. So this has been represented by this OH, and one such element is given by this one, 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus alpha h into ijh. Now for the output layer, we have to calculate the corresponding output. So to find out the output of the last layer or output layer, first we need to calculate the input. Now the input is obtained from the neurons in the hidden layer. So what were the input? So input, if it is represented by IKO for the kth neuron in the output layer, so the weight values are represented by W. So W1K, W2K, and so on. And the corresponding weights are multiplied with the output value. And this output value corresponds to the output of the neurons in the hidden layer. So W1K is multiplied with O1H, W2K is multiplied with O2H, and so on. So there were m number of neurons in the hidden layer, so that's why W1K to WMK, and O1H is the nothing but the output of the first neuron in the hidden layer, the O2H is the output of the second neuron in the hidden layer, and OMH is the output of the mth neuron in the hidden layer. So this O1H, O2H, OMH can be represented or can be obtained from this particular column matrix. Each element of this column matrix or column vector corresponds to the corresponding output of the neuron. So in the matrix notation, we can represent this output, I mean the input of the output layer as W transpose into OH. So dimensionally, it is also matching. So ultimately, this IO is a vector of dimension n cross 1. So that can be represented like n cross m into m cross 1. If you multiply these two, you'll be getting n cross 1. So we have calculated the input here, input to the neurons. So the kth neuron at the last layer. And since the last layer considers tan sigmoid function e to the power alpha I minus e to the power minus alpha I divided by e to the power alpha I plus e to the power minus alpha I. So tan sigmoid function. So by putting the value of IKO, one can easily calculate the individual value of the output at the kth neuron. So in the last layer, we have n number of such neurons. Now one of the neuron is the kth neuron in the last layer. So the overall output can be represented by this vector, as you have seen last time also. So this was done for the hidden layer, and this is for the output layer. So for compact representation, one can identify the set of outputs by means of a vector only. Now let us consider how does backpropagation algorithm help in training this particular neural network. So we have to identify the means through which the different parameters of this LMN multiple layer feed forward neural network is updated. As I've already mentioned, the principle of this backpropagation algorithm is based on the error correction scheme with the steepest descent method. So in case of steepest descent method, it's an error-based learning. And we have to identify that particular value of W, that set of W for which the error is minimum. And in fact, that is the property of supervised learning also. Supervised learning always seeks for a solution which depends upon the error value. I mean, the learning depends upon the error value. As long as the error is non-zero, the system always adapts its weight. That means it continues learning. Whenever the error becomes zero for all the neurons in the output layer, then the system stops learning in the training phase. So in other words, we can say that with reference to an external teacher or external signal, that is the target output, it calculates the error by comparing the target output and the computer output, as we have already mentioned. And based on the error signal, the neural network should modify its configuration, which includes the synaptic connection, that is the weight matrices. And the ultimate objective is to reach to a state that yields a minimum error. So although we are talking about zero error and zero error many times, you must appreciate that it is very difficult to achieve zero error. So while designing a system like this, the machine learning environment, a minimum value of error is specified. People say that, okay, if I consider that 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5 is the threshold, error threshold. So if the error value goes below this, any value of error less than 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 5 can be regarded as a good solution. And accordingly, the way or time it takes, the algorithm takes to reach to that particular level, one can easily draw graph or what is known as convergence accuracy convergence graph. Now, while solving this type of problem, there is a notion of local minima. Sometimes the system output may get back to local minima. So then we find that even after several iterations, the weight is not adjusted properly and the minimum error value cannot go below the threshold. However, for every designer, there is a prescribed limit of error value, which is known as a minimum error, like 10 to the minus 5, minus 6. And if it goes below that, then the system or the algorithm should stop learning. So ultimately, we can say that this problem is nothing but an optimization problem. Optimization between several parameters. For the sake of discussion, I can tell you, if you go for an online training, continuous updation of the weights, that means the data are coming continuously, and accordingly you have to adapt the weight continuously and you have to train the system accordingly. So in that case, the convergence rate of the algorithm should be very large. That means the system must be able to learn very quickly. So under this condition, during online training or online training of the system, 10 to the power minus 4 to 10 to the power minus 5 can be regarded as a acceptable value of error. Here our objective is to minimize the number of iterations as much as possible because the data is coming continuously. On the other hand, if in my database I know what is the set of input and what is the set of output, and accordingly if I want to train the system, then I should aim for having a value or having a situation for which the error value is as close as zero. So I can then target even 10 to the minus 9 or 10 to the minus 10. Then under the second condition, the time requirement is not at all bothering to me because now we are working under offline condition. So once again, there is a kind of optimization between these two different phenomena. Optimization between the performance and the time requirement. If you are very much rigid about attaining the best performance, like having 10 to the minus 8 or 10 to the minus 9, then you have to wait up to several iterations. So 10,000 iterations, 20,000 iterations, 50,000 iterations, and after those 50,000 iterations, perhaps you have come up with a solution with error value less than 10 to the minus 9 or 10 to the minus 8. So now you are sacrificing the time, the convergence time, for the sake of better solution, for the sake of better output, for the sake of better training, which is true for offline. However, for online training, when the data is coming continuously, then you can regard any value of error less than 10 to the minus 4 as an acceptable one. So in this case, you are compromising the error component to some extent for the sake of the convergence time. So ultimately, the problem turns out to be an optimization problem. So now let us take a look how to minimize the error using this particular algorithm. So let us consider that we have the kth neuron at the output layer, and for an input pattern of I, suppose from the kth neuron, the target output we know because it's a supervised kind of learning. So target output is known to me. Suppose this target output is given by TOK. And the output, what you have obtained from calculation, this is nothing but OK. So OK is the output of the kth neuron in the output layer. And TOK or OOK I can write. And TOK is the target output. So this is the obtained output and this is the target output. So obviously, if these two are not same, then one can easily find out the error as TOK minus OOK whole square, half of that. And this error has to be minimized by changing or by adapting the weight value. Now, sometimes, now if we have n number of neurons, so this has been computed for a kth neuron, for example. For the kth neuron, the error EK has been produced. Now, sometimes we are interested in finding out the mean squared error. What about the average error resulting from all the n neurons which are present in the output layer? So that could have been computed with the aid of this equation. This is nothing but the summation. K is equal to 1 to n, EK. So if I put the value of EQ over here, this will be the MSE error. And the total error in the prediction for all the output neurons can be then determined considering the all training session. So this has been computed for a particular training pattern. It will be like Ti. Now to ensure that the training is complete in all respect, so Ti is not the only set of input. Suppose you are providing a set of input for all training session within this range Di to Po. So for all such instances, one has to calculate what is the total error then. So this error E is for a particular training session, for a single training session. And if I consider all the training sessions, and you must appreciate that as you increase the number of such observations from 100 to 1000, 1000 to 10,000 and even more, so you are making the system more perfect. You are exposing the system to a number of training patterns so that the possibility of experiencing some unknown pattern during the testing phase is eliminated to some means. So the total error in the prediction, which is represented by capital E, is nothing but the average error E obtained with a single training session. So this has to be averaged enough, and accordingly, this capital E is produced. So we can consider that this error corresponding to a particular training scenario can be regarded as a function of the variable V and W. Because V and W, these are the two weights, weight matrices. V corresponds to the weight matrix between the first layer and second layer, and W is that between the second and third layer. So this error has to be minimized using the gradient descent method. And according to the gradient descent method, as I have already pointed out, the change in the weight can be represented by times del E, del W. Now, since we have two different weight matrix, so it will be better to consider two different equation over here. So delta V can be represented by minus eta times delta E del V, and delta W is represented by minus eta times del E del W. Eta is known as the learning rate. So why minus sign is put over here? This is because if it is found that del E del V is positive. In fact, this del E del V we have because V is a vector, I mean matrix. So we could have a number of such del E del V value. So that's why this partial differentiation has been used. Now let us consider a particular Vij. A particular weight value which is connected between the ith neuron in the first layer and the jth neuron in the second layer. Now if it is found that the corresponding del E del Vij value is positive, what does it mean? That means as Vij increases, the error value will also increase because del E del Vij is positive. So with the increase in the error value, with the increase in the Vij, the error value increases. So what is our objective? Our objective is to reduce the error value. So what should I do? I should reduce the value of Vij. So if del E del Vij is positive, then the new value of Vij, that is Vij star, can be represented by Vij minus eta times del V eta times del E del Vij, or in other words I can write Vij star is equal to Vij plus delta Vij. So when E increases with Vij, the corresponding del V reduces and it will automatically reduce the value of new Vij, that is Vij star. On the other hand, if this del E del Vij turns out to be negative, means as you increase Vij, the error value reduces, or in other words, as you reduce Vij, the error value increases. So what should be your objective? Your objective is to reduce the error value. So to reduce the error value, the V has to be increased. So if daily del Vij is negative, so eta is a positive quantity, is a learning factor, is a positive quantity. So if this is negative, then minus of this will be positive. So our objective is to reduce the value of E, and that can be done by increasing V, because daily del V is negative. So the same analogy is also applicable for the weights connected between the second layer and third layer, that is W. So we follow the same analogy. Del W is equal to minus eta times daily del W. I have already mentioned the negative sign. Why is it used? It is used to signify the fact that if daily del V or daily del W is greater than zero, then we have to decrease the V and W, or vice versa. And this has been already discussed, what is meant by Vij, what is meant by Wjk, and what do you mean by Ek. Now let's go to the expression directly. So Ek, the kth output, kth error, is represented by Tok minus Ok whole square. This is the error component resulting from the kth neuron in the output layer. And the corresponding modified weight value, Wjk bar or Wjk star, what I can say, is equal to Wjk plus delta Wjk. That is in accordance with steepest descent method. And del Wjk is nothing but minus eta times del Ek del Wjk. Similarly for V, I can write down this equation. So you have to find out the dependence of this Wjk on Ek. So what is Wjk? Wjk is the error value, is the weight value connected between the jth neuron in the hidden layer and kth neuron in the output layer. Now, is it related directly to the error value, Ek? If I take a look at the expression of Ek, I'll find that P is the target error, a target output, and O is the obtained output. Now, obtained output is related to the input to the kth layer, kth neuron, and then this input is having some dependence on the weight value, because the input I at the kth neuron is represented as the weighted sum of the input signal, and these weights are nothing but W, and the input to output, the corresponding relationship is nothing but a nonlinear function, and in this case we have considered 10 sigmoid function. So Ek is related to Ok. So Ek will depend on Ok from this equation, as we can apparently seen, and the value of Ok, the output of the kth neuron, depends upon the input to the kth neuron by virtue of the 10 sigmoid function, or any function as we consider. Here in this case we have considered 10 sigmoid function, for example, and then this input to the kth neuron is related to the weight value. So Ek is not directly related, so that's why we have used a chain rule of differentiation. So del Ek del Wjk is given by del Ek del Ok into del Ok by del Ik into del Ik by del Wjk. And the corresponding relations are given here. Ek is given by half of this, Tok minus Ok whole square. Ok is related to the Ik, input output relationship is the 10 sigmoid function, and the input to the kth neuron is related to the output of the hidden layer, are output of the neurons in the hidden layer by virtue of this weighted average. So now we can find out, one can find out the corresponding partial differentiation, and ultimately these are the results. Del ek by del ok is given by minus t ok minus o ok. So that's why intentionally this half is present over here, so that after differentiation this square will becomes, I mean, if half is there, then if you find out the corresponding partial differentiation, then half and two will get cancelled each other. So that's why this half was there. So minus t ok minus o ok, and del o ok by del ik is represented by this particular function. So if I differentiate, if one can differentiate this function o ok with respect to ik, we can find out what is the expression for del ok, del o ok by del ik. So this is given by the equation in number 10, and del ik by del wij is given by ojh. This can also be verified from equation 8. The dependence of ik on wij, dependence of ik on wij is given by ojh only. Now if these values are substituted over in this particular expression, equation number 3, one can easily find out. Now before putting it in equation number 3, we need to put in equation number 5 to find out this del ek del wjk. So this is computed, the first component del ek by del ok, then this second component del ok by del ik, and then third component del ik by del wjk. And once you get this one, this descent value, gradient value minus del del ek by del wjk, this del wjk can be easily find out. Minus eta times this one. So this is the expression if you multiply entire thing with minus eta. And ultimately the updated value of weights can be represented by this particular equation in equation number 14. So that calculation little bit easier whenever we are going for updating the weights between the second layer and the third layer, second layer and the output layer, hidden layer and the output layer. But remember, this error value does not depend on only on the weight between the second layer and the third layer, but also it depends upon the weight between the first layer and the second layer. So if you would like to find out the corresponding change which must be done for the vector V, or for the matrix V, which is nothing but the weight matrix between the first layer and the second layer. So the formula says that it is all about del ek by del vij with minus eta outside. So del ek by del vij, then you have to identify those elements which can be related to ek. So ek is related to o ok, as you have already seen. O ok is related to I ok, that you have also confirmed, and I ok is not directly related to vij, because what is I ok? I ok is the input to the kth neuron at the output layer, and vij is the weight connection between the first layer and the second layer. So this I is related to the output of the hidden layer by virtue of the weights w. So input to the kth neuron in the output layer is related to the output of the jth neuron in the hidden layer. So that's why del ik del oj Then if I consider the output of the hidden layer, or output neurons in the hidden layer, this is related to the input to the neurons in the hidden layer. So simplistically, one can write del oji by del ij, and then this input is related to bij. Del ij is by del vij. Because from the first layer to the second layer, from the first layer to the hidden layer, the corresponding input to the hidden layer of this architecture is a function of the weights which are connected between the first layer and the hidden layer. So some calculation has already been carried out previously up to this point. First two calculation was done already, so we need to calculate last three: del ik by del ojh, del ojh by del ijh, and del ijh by del vij. So these are the formula. Del ik by del ok we have already computed, minus t ok minus o ok, and del o ok by del I ok is also given. We have already computed this one. And how is ik related to oj? Ik is nothing but the input to the kth neuron, and oj is the output of the jth neuron in the hidden layer. So they are connected by the weight matrix W. So that's why it is simple Wik. And then this del oj by del ij, output versus input in the hidden layer. Remember, in the hidden layer, the function is different. The function is not tan sigmoid. It is log sigmoid, I believe, for this particular case. Let me have a look. I think it is log sigmoid, the function which you have considered. Yeah, it's log sigmoid. So this del O versus del I, the output layer will be different as compared to that in the hidden layer. In this case, it was a tan sigmoid function, and here it is log sigmoid function. So accordingly, one has to find out the exact value. So it is given by theta h into 1 minus ojh into ojh, and del ij, the last one, del ij by del vij, is given by oi. So if all these parameters are incorporated in one equation, this is represented in equation number 26. So del ik by del vij can be obtained clearly, and if you substitute this value, by multiplying this one with minus eta, one can get what is known as delta vij, and the updated value of vij can be obtained from this. Already we have got this vij in equation number 4. Vij star is equal to vij plus delta vij. So if this is represented over here, one can easily find out the new value of vij. So vij is updated in accordance with equation number 28. So it is possible to represent the entire calculation by means of some matrix, so that it can be easily computed using any software platform. If you represent each of the elements in the form of a matrix, so this matrix representation has been given over here, the matrix multiplication, how are they related, the weight matrix with the output vectors and the corresponding error component. The same is true for the matrix V, which is nothing but the weight between the first layer and the second layer, as I mentioned many times. So we have to apply it in incremental mode. That means first one sample, then another sample. And after each training data, we have to update the network parameter, that is V and W. So first, you present one set of data, one sample data, and you carry out this performance. Let's allow the system to settle down. Then you take another set of sample data, do the same thing, and allow the system to settle down, and do it repeatedly until and unless the error value becomes minimum for any sustaining data. Then one can say that the updation is complete, and now the system is trained properly for this given set of training patterns. And obviously, if the testing pattern is different, then the system might not perform better or might not perform well. And if it is so, then there is certain difficulty, certain limitation in the training process. Then you have to revisit the training process again. Then why the system performance is so poor during the testing phase, and accordingly you have to change the architecture or some other parameters within the architecture so that it can provide satisfactory performance both for the training data as well as for the testing data. Now with this, I have come to the end of this particular lecture, which talks about the training in connection to the artificial neural network.